face up. You go to the bathroom.
Changed the form and style of the model 9 times to allow for cracks and changes in conception. A stone sculptor's greatest challenge is to avoid cutting away too much rock, since once it is removed, it is impossible to replace. By constantly reworking the scale model, Borglum was able to test his ideas and manipulate the look of each face before they were actually cut into the mountain. Once Borglum was convinced of his artistic direction, he would measure the marker and transfer the dimensions to the mountain using an ancient sculptor's tool called the pointing system.
Old barriers and opened up new frontiers. They broadened our nation and they strengthened its foundation. And they chiseled into our national soul the yearning for freedom, democracy, equality, and justice. The conviction that all people have the right to life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness.
With the medical who wonder where our power December before I think they'll still be here. What they will think about us. And let them hope that at least they will give us the benefit.
Sometimes as deep as that, in order to give it color, so that you round it, you know what I mean? And same way here, and underneath here. You see, I couldn't leave it as you would actually see the face at this
head size and looking right there.
Frontier, and our nation's foundation.
tested the use of dynamite to Borglum on an earlier job. By the time the artist came to Rushmore, he knew how to remove exact amounts of stone with each charge. To enable local hard rock miners to act as assistant sculptors, Borglum employed a measuring system called pointing. A circular plate, marked off in degrees, was mounted on the head of a studio model. One end of a bar was attached to the center of the plate. From the bar, a plumb bob was lowered until it touched the model. Measurements made on the model were multiplied by 12 and transferred to the mountain by the use of similar but larger devices mounted on the sculpture. Marks were made at each point, telling workmen how much stone to remove. Holes were then drilled for dynamite charges. The pointer was the most important worker on the mountain after the sculptor himself. In addition to pointers, the construction crew included powdermen, winchmen, blacksmiths, call boys, and as many drillers as the budget would allow at a given moment. During most of the construction, the workers hung over the side of the mountain in bows and chairs, a swing seat and harness. With their jackhammers and other equipment, the men were raised and lowered by cables attached to winches. It was customary to blow off the morning's work at the noon lunch break, and to blast again at 4 o'clock when the shift ended for the day. The drillers became so skilled, they could block out a nose to within a few inches of the finished surface, shape the lips and grade the contours of the neck, cheeks and brows. As they approached the final surface of the sculpture, the drillers carefully honeycombed the rock with holes 2 to 3 inches apart. With the granite thus weakened, steel wedges were used to chisel off sections. The remaining pock-like drill marks on the faces were removed with a small air hammer and facing bit, a finishing process called bumping. It left the granite as smooth as a concrete sidewalk. The Washington head was unveiled on the 4th of July, 1930. In 1936, President Franklin D. Roosevelt spoke of the permanent importance of Mount Rushmore at the dedication of the Jefferson head.
10,000 years from now, I think we can meditate and wonder whether our descendants, because I think they'll still be here, what they will think about us, and let us hope that at least they will give us the benefit of the doubt, that they will believe that we have honestly striven in our day and generation to preserve for our descendants a decent land to live in and a decent form of government to operate under.
In 1941, as a final dedication was being planned, Gutzon Borglum died, leaving his son Lincoln to close down the work. When he first arrived in the Black Hills, Borglum was 57. Until his death 17 years later, Rushmore had been the focus of his life, his all but impossible dream. In both its conception and realization, Rushmore is uniquely American, proclaiming bold ideals and big aspirations, celebrating the spirit of our people and the sweep of our civilization, reminding us of the hope a democratic society offers to the future. It is a monument no less to the men who, working together, transformed a lofty dream into a colossal reality, a work of art for the ages. A monument's dimensions shall be determined by the importance to civilization of the events commemorated, Borglum had said when he began. Let us place there, carved high, as close to heaven as we can, our leaders, their faces, to show posterity what manner of men they were. Then breathe a prayer that these records will endure until the wind and rain alone shall wear them away.
Flowers into bloom to the delight of the wildflowers.